Welcome back to End is the Future, a podcast that brings together great minds to address the opportunities and challenges of making businesses both sustainable and profitable. I am Ilham Kadri, the CEO of Solvay, and I'm delighted to be your host today. If you are as passionate about sustainable business as I am, let's explore how End is the Future together. Today, I'm delighted to welcome explorers Gilles, Denis, and Nathan Goffart to the End is the Future podcast for what I'm sure will be a fascinating discussion. Earlier this year, Gilles and Nathan set off on the Nanok Expedition, a unique six-month triathlon consisting of three disciplines: ski crossing along the Arctic Circle, kayaking at sea, and vertical climbing across Greenland. By the way, their mission went beyond just exploration. They also collaborated with well-known institutions and universities in Belgium to provide in-situ measurements and samples for climate research. Solvay is very proud to have sponsored Gilles and Nathan on this exciting expedition. And I can't wait to hear about their incredible adventures. Gilles and Nathan, thank you so much for being here today. So for those in our audience who may not know, can you briefly, in few words, explain the Nanok Expedition and how did you come up with the idea of for Nanok? Yeah. Why Nanok?
Yeah, of course. Well, I think you explained it very well. But if I need to give one sentence to explain Nanok Expedition, it's really a untypical triathlon in wilderness Greenland. And of course, you have two other parts of that. So while untypical triathlon is because it had three parts on the project. First of all, it was a sport project with polar expedition, like you explained. Mm-hmm. We did 450 kilometers crossing from west to east the Greenland, so it's in the glacier. Very cold temperature, weather was quite chilly, like minus 42, minus 45 degrees we had. Second part was the kayak part, like you said. We did about 600 kilometers on the west coast of the Greenland. And this was paddling throughout a big glacier, from glacier. It was just amazing.
Yeah.
And the last part was the climbing part. So, for the people who know climbing, we call it doing a big wall. So what we did is we did a wall that you need to take several days to climb it, and you sleep on the wall. Other than that, we also have an important scientific part and human part on it. Scientific is because Jill and I, we wanted to give a purpose about environment and climatic change.
Yeah.
And, we find the idea of, the science, because they need a lot of, data and stuff like that. In Arctic. And we were there for that. So it was amazing.
Yeah.
And human is about the movie, and we wanted to give message to people to push themselves to be more perseverance, resilience, stuff like that. It was really important for us to say to the people, you need to believe, you need to dream.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a dream for us, and we gave everything to do it.
Yeah.
And if we can do it, you can do it. Yeah. So this was a bit the message.
Was that dream scaring you at all, or?
Yes, of course, because it's been a long time preparing, and even when you are into it, you never know if you're going to succeed or not. But I think it's good that to be scared.
Yeah,
then,
of course.
You give
if not,
more
it's
more.
Not big enough.
Exactly.
I'm asking a question at our team. They know. I said, you know, dream big. And if your dreams are not scaring you, they're not big enough.
Well, I think you asked how it started.
The origin of the idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, the origin came in 2016. The first time I went to Greenland, I discovered this place that was huge and absolutely amazing with infinite possibilities. And along with the place and the people, I discovered three sports disciplines that really appealed to me.
Ah.
And I started thinking how I could put this together into one big, great expedition. My whole life until then has always been trying to figure out a way to, first of all, find my very own path. I have the necessity to build my own path. And then secondly, try to have a positive impact in the world. So there was this idea, and looking at adventurers, I thought, this is really the best job in the world to be able to inspire people to be the best version of themselves. And so I wanted to be one. since 2008, since I was 18 years old and I tried the Arctic.
Yeah.
And so I obsessed over this idea of putting those three sports discipline for 2 years. And I didn't have the skills. I didn't have the knowledge. I didn't have the necessary endurance or physical capacity to do this thing. It was way beyond what I could achieve at that moment. But I knew that I trusted the process of taking small steps towards my goal, however big and ambitious and crazy it was. And I did what the only thing I knew how to was I gave it a name. I put a date on it. I gave it a name to the expedition.
Why a name? So can you explain?
Because if you can identify very clearly, and giving a name to something is identifying it, recognizing it, is the first milestone, I think.
Yeah. And why this name?
Well, actually, so Nanok Expedition, we chose it together. 2 years later. So that's originally it was called the Greenlandic Triathlon.
The Greenland, okay. So you said a name. And
so give it a name.
Timeline?
Put a timeline, put a date on it, make it real.
So
and
what
talk
was
about
your first day?
The first day was slightly earlier than the reality. It was for my 30th birthday, so 2020, two years earlier.
So now we know your age.
Yeah.
So a bit earlier, but you continued. Yeah. And then?
Yes. Name timeline.
Speak about it.
And then talk about it. Because if you want to put something out into the world, out into reality, it's not enough. You have to get it out of your head. And so you have to talk about it. And so I started doing a social media and talking about it and saying out loud what I was going to do, even though I didn't have a partner and there was no question I would do this alone.
Yeah.
And then I started training, believing that taking those small steps would eventually lead me somewhere.
Yeah.
And I started training and hoping that in doing all of that, I would be able to inspire the ideal partner, which came 2 years
which
later.
But then when you start talking about it, what was the response? Were people telling you you're just crazy, right?
Yeah.
Or people say, it's another dream. Let's see. What was the reaction of people around you or social media?
The reaction is interest.
Mixed bet.
Because I believe in the, you talked about dreaming big. I believe in the power of dreaming big, dreaming really big. Because if you dream big, people either think you're crazy or they think you're genius.
Yeah.
But in both cases, you leave a mark.
Yeah.
And you impact people and they look at you differently.
Yeah.
And that's something that I think is very powerful.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so some people were thinking I was crazy. Other people were maybe thinking, wow, this is maybe something that will happen and it's amazing. And
and this is very profound. Dreaming big, go after your passion, and go and plan for it. Plan to win. So you collaborated with several scientists for climate research, and in fact, on the expedition, gathered data never before collected in such condition. And this is a significant contribution to science and our understanding of climate change. Could you both tell us about it and how was it on the field? Can you share some data, results?
So it's a bit too early for results. The scientists need time to do their own
digest
work.
All of this.
Exactly. We just handed them the samples, the measurements. Now they have everything. What's really satisfying is it started really small at the Royal Observatory of Belgium, and then it started growing and gathering interest.
So you started in Belgium, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
In here in Brussels, in the Royal Institute, you said, right?
Yes, Royal Observatory of Belgium.
Observatory. And then it started then to blossom.
Exactly. Yeah. And then we ended up having five experiments with four Belgian universities and one research center in Denmark. And I think it's a bit long to explain exactly what was done. We came back with... we made in situ measurements. We collected data. We collected samples in five different experiments. And what's really interesting is saying it started small, but now the scientists are employing PhD PhD students to work on those data. Yeah. So it's getting really into something serious. But on the field, it was really good to have the science for us on the field, because it became really important. Yeah. It became a source of motivation, purpose.
Yeah.
And when things went slightly sideways with the kayaking part, which we couldn't do it on the East Coast for permit reasons and stuff like that. Then we switched mentality. We were really looking. That was a hard time.
It was a sobering moment, it looks like.
Yeah.
Why? Because you couldn't get the permits and you couldn't go on the path you planned for it before,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Yeah.
So you had to change plan, right?
Yeah. So we had to change plan.
You had to adapt.
So how you had each other's, what happened?
This is a good question. Well, it was one of the hardest stuff we had on the expedition.
Really?
Because, I mean, you prepare yourself for 4 years. The kayak part was one of the big part actually we had to do.
Yeah.
And we were really trying for that, willing to do that, because nobody did that before for just one people 20 years ago. So it was a big, big, big challenge. And we were ready for that.
Yeah.
And in a sudden, 2 weeks before we go, they say, oh no, sorry, actually you cannot do it anymore because we forgot to say that you need a permit, but we didn't give it to you. Like, okay, we need to change all our plans. We are in the middle of nowhere. How are we going to do that? And so, it's big.
Yeah,
difficult to digest.
Moment,
yes. And so we had to, I think, find out a way to redo something. And this is good. I think in all big expedition, I'm sure everybody have this moment of difficulties.
It never goes as planned, right?
No, exactly.
Did you have a team behind you on the backstage supporting you with this?
Yes and no. We did everything together. So people were there to support us, but I mean, not to help us.
So coming back to this, I think your thought process was saying, I had to change my plan.
Yeah.
You talk to each other, you find a new way. But you had science as an objective,
right? Exactly. And that's what saved us, is we thought, okay, now the kayaking part, the more adventurous side of it is slightly lost. So we're going to go full on with science, which is great, because in the end, it turned out that the kayaking part got really interesting in its science aspects, because we focused everything. We tailor-made this new kayaking itinerary based on the science that we wanted to perform.
Okay.
And that was eye-opening. And we did far more during this kayaking part than we could have done on the East Coast, where we would have had a lot of pressure.
Yeah.
Rough times,
not
so much the mental space to really perform
on the science
aspect.
So outstanding. So what you are telling us is you readapted very quickly. You reimagined the path.
Yeah,
you find obviously you had the purpose of science, but science took even more space. And we are science companies, so our science auditors here from the audience from Solvay, they will love that you prioritize science to kayak, although I'm sure there are a lot of kayak fans. But that's interesting on that path, how you reimagine. So all the pictures of your expedition are wonderful, but I especially liked seeing the ones of your climbing adventure where you opened the path in a massive 550-meter cliff, which will make it safer for other climbers in the future, hopefully. You were hundreds of meters in the air for 11 days doing this. And my favorite picture is the one of the two of you in your tent in the sky above the clouds, looking up at the northern lights. And I love this one. I think I need to have, a nice signature on
With
it.
With pleasure.
that must have been the most incredible experience, right? And you also gave the new path a great name. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, of course. Well, like you say, climbing was just insane. I mean, the landscape where we were, it's amazing. I need to put it in context, but I mean, you are at 400 meters, middle of a cliff, and you have, when it's good weather, of course, huge view on all the valley and the fjords that's coming in. You are 2,000 meter high in sea level, and you see the sea, so it's quite rare for that.
Yeah.
You have a glacier on your right, on your left, sorry. On the right, if you go a bit further up, you see the ice cap.
Wow.
And huge mountain everywhere. So,
wow.
And like you say, in the nighttime, you have big sunset, big sunrise, clouds, sea clouds. and also Northern Lights. So yeah. Whew, amazing.
Yeah.
So yeah, it was quite incredible. And now for the name, we call it Imaka. Well, actually, sorry, it's Maka.
Maka. And what does this mean?
It's been like we can say the Inshallah local, actually.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, it's like, well, I don't know. We don't know what's happened tomorrow. Let's see. Never know.
Yeah.
And why we call it, for three reasons we call it this name. First of all, but we wanted to give it an Inuit name, of course, it's Inuit words.
Yeah.
The second is we quite experienced that during our traveling and during our expedition, like logistic problems and stuff. Like we were like, okay, guys, where are our stuff? They're coming tomorrow. Well, I never know. Maybe tomorrow, maybe not.
We shall see.
So we experienced that quite a lot.
Inshallah, exactly. I love it.
and the third one, I think is, well, people maybe don't know exactly what is opening a new route and climbing a new route, but climbing, for me, opening a route on a cliff is really a step in the unknown. What I mean is you never know when you're climbing where you're going to go through. Of course, at the beginning, you look to see the cliff and say, okay, we could go there. But when you are on it, actually, sometimes I climb 10 meters, my protection is 10 meters below, and I'm stuck. And I cannot go in even further. I say, oh, no, I cannot go there. Where I need to go, left, right, and see Maka. Let's see. Yeah. Let's see what's happened. Yeah, yeah. You don't know, but you need to continue.
You need to continue.
And I think this is quite a good way.
It's about, you know, focus on what you control, what you don't control, and Maka.
I might actually steal it.
And that's be present in the moment. So it's even more important when you are in those unique situations, right? So what about you?
I totally agree with Nathan. It was those views that we have, this experience up there. Sometimes I had to slap myself to realize this was true, because
how many photos you took, for example?
But actually,
thousands?
Not so much.
Because when you're in the world, everything needs to be attached.
Yeah.
Because hundreds of meter high, it's vertical, always hanging. Yeah. So cameras, those things are not easy to deal with. You can drop your phone, you can drop your camera.
Yeah.
More than that, maybe it's a bit selfish, but I mean, it's in my head. It's the image in the head. I don't want to take the picture and don't profit from the moment.
But we are happy that you took some pictures for us, right? On that note, you must have seen many inspiring sights in nature than the rest of us can only dream of. What was that like for you? What's your preferred one?
In my head.
Well, there was this moment where we visited this glacier front in Kalegalit Fjord.
Yeah.
So in the south of Greenland, there's a fjord called Kalegalit. And there's a glacier front that comes all the way to the sea.
Yeah.
And this is a place I had been to since 2016 every year, because I'm working there guiding, taking people to this particular fjord and glacier. Yeah. But seeing it from a kayak with Nathan, and then that year especially, was amazing, because it was both absolutely incredible to see, but also quite frightening. You would see those huge pieces of ice just exploding and popping out of the glacier front and falling into the sea, creating huge waves, and it was cracking and banging everywhere, like cannon shots, and it was very, very, very powerful.
Wow.
But it was also so active. Yeah. I had never seen it so active in all those years, and actually this glacier has retreated so much.
Wow. So you could see the difference, right?
Yeah. See the difference. And
so
actually,
for skeptical of climate change, you've seen it.
Yeah, one of the most obvious signs that we saw was, again, during the kayak part, we had a topographical map from 2001, so 21 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And we had selected carefully with the scientists three fjords that we had to go to. And we had to paddle all the way to the bottom of the fjords, to the glacier front, to go and collect the filtered samples for them.
Yeah.
And doing so, we realized that each and every glacier front that we had to go to were 5 to 7 kilometers back from where it was indicated on the map.
Yeah.
And so if you make the math, 7 kilometers in 21 years, that's 300 meters on average
per year.
And that's how much it retreats. And if you consider the number of glaciers around Greenland, that's
insane.
Absolutely insane.
It's insane. So that's a great fact you bring back, you know, as an observation, and obviously the urgency of climate change. And you know, we are part of the industry and we are part of the problem, but the solution. And we need new solutions to reimagine. I imagine that during those 5 months, there were many, many ups and downs. Was there ever a time you were tempted to give up? If so, what gave you the strength to continue to overcome these difficulties? And also, I wonder, looking at you both, you are friends, buddies. Yeah. When did it start? Were there times where you agreed to disagree? Were there disputes? Tell us a bit how it works. Is there a leader in this couple?
Yes. No. But to give the answer for the first question, I don't think in any moment we wanted to give up, for sure. But of course, we had some difficulties and some problem on the way. So it's obvious. And how you can cope with that? The first one for me is the training. Actually, when you train, you fail. And no, you know what is it.
Yeah.
And so you are ready for that.
Yeah.
And actually it's good to be ready for that, because you're going to give everything on the day when something bad happened to continue and go forward. So it's a bit like professional sport people, they 90% of the time they're training, and 10% of the other time what they do is they compete and they try to succeed. But of course, it's never succeed. Sometimes it's a lot of failure, and one time you succeed, but they get trained for that and they are willing to do that. Then expedition is a bit the same, and you need to try to get that in your mind to mean that, yeah, of course you can fail. It's normal to fail because it's risk. And it's for this that not a lot of people doing that, but you're doing it for that reason also, because it's risky and failures exist. Yeah. And I think that the second point is you need to go step by step, because you can fail something, but it's not mean that the expedition is a failure also.
Yeah.
Sometimes you can miss a part, but if you keep going forward, keep thinking about the next step, and not looking backwards, you can continue. I have a lot of stuff to do yet.
And Gilles did it already, right? I mean, he was there, he accommodated. It was your first?
It was my fourth
experience there, right?
The polar crossing and polar expedition. Yeah.
So and did you rely more on Gilles, you know, knowledge, know-how, you know?
It's
interesting. Huh?
Yeah, this is the good fact between him and I.
Yeah.
I mean, we're good friends, but also I think we have a really good complementarity between the skills, the strength, and our weakness.
Yeah.
And so together, I think it's for this we're doing such a good teamwork.
So that's the power of the end. That's the objective of this podcast. So tell me the end, and you. Where are you complementary?
Oh.
I know Greenland, non-Greenland. So that's clear. What else in the skills?
In the skills, I mean, he knows a lot more about the knowledge about the cold that I didn't had. So you need to know that in the cold, really cold temperature, you need to react and act really, really well. And you need to know all of that. And so he had all the knowledge about that with this Yukon expedition and what he did in the past. I don't know, for myself.
Well, I think the way I see it is... I was the older one with maybe more of the experience in the polar expeditions, polar regions, in Greenland in itself, kayaking too. But as much as I have faith in my projects, my dreams, and we all have our moments of doubts, and I'm someone who reflects a lot, put myself in question a lot.
Yeah.
And so I would describe myself as being more like the old guy with the knowledge and the experience. And then Nathan came to complement that in the most beautiful way, being this extremely dynamic, energetic, with an optimism that can move mountains.
Could you have done it without him?
No. Of course
and vice versa, right?
It's the same.
Yeah. Very interesting. So that the complementarity which supports you.
And I think if we're talking about business or leading a project, to have those two people is very strong. The guy which has infinite faith in himself, in infinite trust in the world, in himself, and motivation, lots of energy. Obviously, Nathan had more of athlete background than I did.
Yeah.
And then they have the guy that is more paused, that will think and look at every detail, be very perfectionist, but also sometimes too much. So to have this complementarity, it
gives you a balance. Yeah.
It gives a balance, pushing and knowing when to stop.
Amazing. What's the wisdom? And indeed, it speaks to the business people we are, to scientific people we are, because you're right. You are both moonshotters and 100%ers, because you need to be precise and detailed. You have this complementarity. So what you accomplish is certainly not for the faint of heart. And in many ways, it was a risk, right? It takes a certain mindset, a lot of preparation, a lot of resilience to risk forging a new path or going into the unknown, as you mentioned, Nathan. And in a different way, businesses also need to take a risk and push the envelope. And I've always said that we can learn a lot from explorers like you. What lessons do you think business can take from your experience?
Well, if I can answer that question, I think a lot of the elements are in your question.
Yeah.
There are many parallels I'm sure we can do between the way a businessman or woman approaches his or her business and the way an adventurer approaches his expedition, even more so with an entrepreneur in his startup. I've heard preparation. I've heard risk management and resilience. You said you talked about the unknown, and for me, that I'll refer to dare to push the boundaries, go further,
think outside the box,
getting outside your comfort zone. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And
the purpose, by the way, starts with the why. The purpose.
Yeah, the purpose.
And, and then the mindset.
Yeah.
That appeals to me, to passion, motivation. And I'll add another aspect in our case and in the business case that is very important, is to surround yourself with the right people.
Yeah.
The like-minded idealist.
Yeah.
And the thing with adventures, which I think makes it interesting, is that they push it to the extreme. Because I was quite interested recently to have someone reminding me that the word passion comes from the Latin word passio, which means actually suffering.
Yeah, yeah.
So passion is something that burns you from the inside out.
Yeah.
And someone truly passionate will be someone who will give everything, his entire life, his entire being to his heart, art.
Yeah.
And so in that sense, he has to push everything to the extreme, his methods, his
training,
intuition, training, experience to the extreme. And so that makes it an interesting case study.
So determination is important, like in business.
Yeah.
To be determined to go after your passion.
Yeah. So I think this is a question that needs that deserves more development. But if you're talking about preparation, for example, preparation is absolutely key. You take your project, you divide it into those small goals, and then you have your project plan.
Mm-hmm.
For example, okay, I went to kayak 1,000 kilometer coast along one of the roughest coasts in the world.
Yeah.
But first, I need to know how to sit in a kayak, because back then I didn't know how.
Yeah, yeah.
So and then you need to be good at it.
Yeah, yeah.
Now define good and put some incremental goals towards that ideal good. And so preparation, risk management, to know when to stop, consistency, because... Yeah. I love this phrase, but I think you love it too.
Yeah.
By Denzel Washington.
Yeah.
He talks about consistency, because nothing of worth ever comes easy.
Yeah.
He says, dreams without goals are just dreams.
Yeah.
And then he carries on saying, because without commitment, you'll never start. And without consistency, you'll never finish.
Yeah. Wow.
And it's about that discipline, consistency. You need the drive to to be able to dive, yeah. but then you'd be also be able to keep going and going yeah. and going.
And this speaks to our hearts because it's about the human elements and the human connection we are talking about, right? At Solvay, it's true, it's in our DNA. Actually, our founder used to climb the Matterhorn yeah. mountain, all right? Yeah, in yeah. Switzerland.
In Switzerland.
And he did it at age 80 plus, right?
Crazy.
There is still a cabin of a fusion yeah, with yeah, his yeah, name yeah. out there. But we are so proud. You said you are proud of it. We are proud of you, right?
Thanks
I mean,
lot.
This is just Thanks. Amazing. I'm sure many people listening will be inspired by you and want to follow in your footsteps. What advice would you tell them?
I think the first one is, for me, I have a sentence. Life belongs to those who believe in the beauty of their dreams. And it's really that. Just never give up. Go and try it. I mean, even if you don't succeed, yeah. it's nothing.
And dream big.
So, yeah, dream big. The other one is train hard, physically and mentally.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
if you're well prepared, I think you are ready for everything. Yeah. And even if it's not going well, you don't have some deception or anything. Because you train hard and you try to get
yeah.
everything.
Yeah.
I think sharing also, it's quite important because dreaming is good, but I think dream is only real really when it's sharing
yeah.
and you shared something, you don't keep it for yourself.
Yeah.
So it's quite good to find a way also to share it. And, last but not least, I think if you go on a polar expedition, don't forget your toilet paper.
And would you have enough toilet paper for?
We have just enough. Sorry if I say that.
And about you, is it exhaustive?
We had enough. We had enough. I would say never fail to try because the only real failure yeah. is not trying.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
yeah.
fear, remorse, yeah. not regrets.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the first thing for me.
Yeah.
Then I really like this phrase by Jacques Brel. I put it in my very first presentation years ago, that true talent is the strong desire to achieve your dreams.
Yeah.
And he says that the rest is only sweat and discipline.
Yeah.
So try not to compare.
Yeah.
And don't blame yourself for not being talented enough.
Yeah.
Blame yourself for being lazy
yeah.
or not putting yeah. the work in. Because I don't believe.
Because
I don't believe in the accident of nature.
Yeah.
People
yeah.
are not
yeah.
the natural talent. I think it's about work and dedication.
Absolutely.
And,
absolutely. And I think it's about the grit. It's more important than
yeah.
talent, right?
Yeah.
And you need to have hard work. And I say to my people, IQ is a commodity. You need more than IQ these days, right? You didn't talk about fun. I hope you had fun as well. What's next for you? Do you dream about your next thing?
Yeah. Well,
still
I have,
a secret? Or?
I have expedition. No, I have expedition in my head, maybe
yeah.
more in the challenge and sport way.
Yeah.
But I think, first of all, what I wanted to do is change a bit my professional career and go more in the guiding and maybe do a alpine guide and bring people like you and I to try to push the limits.
Really? Okay.
And more than that, maybe
I can try with you.
With pleasure.
Frankly, after this,
whenever.
I need a lot of training. But
wow, we can push that, no problem.
That's
yeah.
nice.
And not more for that, I think do that with kids also. They had some difficulties.
Wow.
I think bring them to the mountain and push them beyond their limits.
Yeah.
I think it's really good
yeah.
stuff to discover yourself.
Outstanding.
And for those kids, could be great. Yeah.
And what about you? What's next?
What's
next? in your heart and mind and dreams?
So in my heart and dreams, this project made me really think. And I think finally I can say I found the way to live from adventure. So now I'm diving into it 100%. And I made two observations during this expedition. The first one being that adventures are the natural ambassadors for field science, if we're talking about remote areas at
yeah,
least.
Yeah.
And that allows for very ecological and very economical ways to do science, much more than what is done at the moment. I could put numbers and on it, et cetera. But throughout all our talks with the scientists,
yeah.
This is what came up really strongly. So I believe adventurers have a role to play, and I want to take mine seriously.
Yeah.
And I want to do expeditions, not only one, but I want to build something that will be able to put expeditions at the service of science. And like we did with the kayaking, tailor-make those expeditions to the needs of the scientists.
Yeah.
And my scientific background also helps. So that's great.
Yeah.
So that's the first observation I made. Then the second observation is almost as important. And it's the fact that scientists need a voice.
Yeah.
They need a voice, and they need that we get it out to the general public.
Absolutely.
Loud and clear.
Yeah.
And there's a need for vulgarization.
Absolutely.
Also,
education.
And so, education.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so, I think those two together, they are very important.
Yeah.
And that's why in May 2024, I want to go back to Greenland and go back on the ice cap and go back for another expedition and carry on the science that has been started. Because I think, I'm sure things have just started.
Yeah.
I want to carry on the science that has been started with those scientists and take it back on the ice cap, take it back along the coast. And for those two reasons, help scientists get a voice and do allow them to do this cheaper, more easy access and above all more ecological way to do science. Yeah. And I really believe in the communication aspect, because we had this phrase with Solvay, which we like came up with it reading something, I don't remember, is that today an adventurer's responsibility isn't to conquer lands, there's no more lands to conquer, it's to conquer hearts.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And adventure is human first, and we talk to the hearts of people, and then from that you can say anything, you can spread messages which will go much deeper into people's hearts and souls. And if we're talking about climate change, environment, protection, these are very important nowadays, of course. And I think I can play a role in that, and I'm really excited about it.
Outstanding. I mean, you have just highlighted the power of the end. I mean, the two of you complementary. You are adventurer and explorers and scientific people, and you support science. You talk about the beauty of communicating, specifically fighting the climate change. Yeah. You have beautiful souls, and you are strong as I've never seen, right?
Thank you.
And those big dreams and achieving those big dreams, that's what makes sense. And that's what exactly we want our people to do. So thank you. Thank you so much, Gilles and Nathan, for joining us today. Your passion for exploration, for forging new paths and advancing climate science is so motivating to all of us. And there is so much we can learn. I can continue this conversation for so long, but I'm sure we'll continue the journey together. Thank you. Thank you very much for inspiring
us.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us today. For more information or to listen to other episodes, visit our website at solvay.com. And if you like these podcasts, don't forget to subscribe. Until next time, be safe.